thank you, Sven, for the introduction, and you for coming. I'm Matteo De Maida. I'm coming from Treviso, that is close to little town close to Venice. And I'm an art director and photographer focused on good causes. And let me explain you a bit what I mean for good causes. I'm telling you a bit about my experience at work. I was working after studying graphic design and photography. I started working in this company around the countryside of Venice. The company is called H Farm and works essentially for digital campaigns, commercial campaigns. And there I have learned a lot about team building and working with people. I was creating campaigns for these international brands. But after 6 years of working there, I wasn't really satisfied about what I was communicating. So I asked myself how I could see myself in 40 years. And I haven't seen me really well. So I needed some messages and some content that has a meaning in my work. And working with commercial, I didn't have this feeling. So I quit my job, and I started to collaborate with a social project. So I have two kind of fields so where I work, and it's with NGOs, like building their campaigns, making reportages, and also for branded content who speaks about sustainability. Let me show you a project I have collaborated with. It's an atlas of the best cycling initiatives in the world. And it's a project by Selle Royale, that is a saddles brand, Italian saddles brand. So we decided to make this website to collect many initiatives around the world about cycling, and where the initiatives could subscribe to the website and participate to the project. So finally, we have selected. I did the research and the selection of the stories, and I have covered a couple of stories that I'm showing to you. This is one in China. I think it's a bit dark, but anyway. So this story is about the bikes that were the jobs that are made with bicycles around the Forbidden City in China. In Beijing. So I have collaborated with an association called Smarter Than Car to map all these jobs around the Forbidden City that are all made with bicycle. Another story I have covered, it's about Maya Pedal Association in Guatemala. And it's about this association that recycles bicycle scraps from the United States to make these beautiful tools for the farmers of this community, like to help this woman to with this bicycle blender that helps her to make aloe shampoo, or water pumps, or bicycle degrainer. So I'm jumping to my collaboration with NGOs now. As Italian, I feel really much this period of crisis with refugees, and I needed to do something to collaborate to express this situation. So I started collaborating with Emergency, that is an Italian NGO that usually works on the Middle East in conflict areas. But in the last years, they decided to work also in Italy because of this migrants' arrival. So here we are in the ghetto of Rignano Scalo, that is in Puglia, where the 40% of the Italian tomatoes are coming from. And here there is this camp, this ghetto, of these little houses. It's a real community. Of course, they don't have water or electricity. But they have the kind of little restaurant, little shops. There are two mosques. Sadly, also prostitution. They work there, of course, to be close to the fields where they work. So an emergency decided to go there with this mobile clinic to help the refugees. And so I have documented their work. And this is a maternity ward in Palermo in Sicily. So with all the images and the content, we have made an exhibition that went around Italy and finally ends up in the headquarters of the United States in Switzerland. So continuing with the migration topic, I have collaborated with Colors Magazine as a researcher on the chap. It was an issue about migration in the world, but I was focused on the Italian chapter. So we tried to make a survival guide for migrants. So we have kind of traced the three main routes where the migrants can work or can find a job. So the first in the south, it was the one of the ghetto. That of course it follows the seasonal harvesting. So they move to Sicily when there are the strawberries or potato season. They move to Puglia for the tomatoes or in Calabria for the oranges that also Fanta use. In the middle of Italy, we have jobs mainly focused on tourism, and so migrants sell objects. And in the north, there is the factory and manufacturing jobs they can do. So this map was inside the magazine. There were many maps also about other countries in the world, and this is the one about Italy. You could take it with yourself. I have kind of continued my work with Emergency, collaborating with the Italian curators of the Italian pavilion at the last architecture biennale, because the architecture that were the curator are also the architects for Emergency that made the mobile clinics. So the idea is kind of similar. So with the budget of the Biennale, they bought five of these devices. This device that is kind of really ordinary and simple and ugly. And they asked to five emerging architects to customize them and to donate to five associations in Italy that works on important topics like culture, environment, healthcare, problems correlated with mafia, etc. So here are some examples how they customized the devices. And the curators asked me to direct a video that was an introduction of the Italian pavilion. So this short film was focused on the contrast between ethic and the aesthetic. That was also the topic of the main Biennale. I have made this short movie about the building of this object that is very ugly, but thanks to the association and the work of the architects, become beautiful and helpful. This was the installation at the Biennale. The film was projected directly to one of these devices. So I want to hand my talk about speaking about also some Italians that are not happy with this fact. So there is in Abano Terme, that is a little town in the north of Italy, there is this group, a large group of Italians that says no against migrants. So because the Italian government is dividing the migrants in the cities equally, they send them to this old military barracks that are now empty. They should be like 200 migrants for barrack, and they should stay there for a couple of months. But finally, these barracks are full of migrants, like 1,000 migrants also in just one military barrack. And they stay there also for 2 years, waiting for their documents that never arrive. So these people like go in front of the military barracks where they know that the migrants are arriving, and they stop them. So they also sleep there, as you can see in the right image, to be always 24 hours there. So, but with the journalist, we worked on this topic that is called Samuele Cafasso. We wanted to go a bit more deeper on the subject and understanding why these people are so angry. So in Abano Terme was a really popular city for tourism, for spas and hotels. Also many Germans went there to retire some years ago. But because of the crisis, some of them had to close. So now they are abandoned, like this. This is the president of this group. So the Abano Terme, so the citizens of Abano Terme started voting for this really populist party that you maybe have heard that is called Lega Nord. They voted him, he became the mayor, but after 2 days, he were arrested for some mafia correlated issues. So I guess they should find a way where to put all this anger, and they built this group. So this is another hotel, abandoned hotel. So hope it was nice to hear. I hope did you enjoy it. Thank you.
Super.
Just take a seat, I think we'll come back to it.
Okay.
Super, thank you very much. I think we'll just continue straight away and then catch up with the conversation afterwards. I'm not sure if you can write your questions to Boris still. If not, just keep them in mind and we'll come back afterwards. Isabelle, would you come up next? Isabelle Chapuis from Paris works, well, in between fashion and beauty, which might sound a bit, and I'm over-exaggerating, superficial. But what I like so much about the work that I saw from her is that she has a subtle way of questioning the stereotypes and constructing a variety of ideas of beauty. And I'm looking forward to seeing it. Please welcome Isabelle.
I'm really happy to be here and to share my work with you today. So I'm based in Paris. I've been graduated 12 years ago in graphic design. I started to work as a freelancer, but in the real life, this job was really not for me. Like sitting hours in front of a computer didn't make me really happy. So I left France and I went to travel on my own in Asia for quite a long time. And then I decided to settle in Middle East for a few months. And there I really started to build my own portfolio that was combining art and fashion. Can I pass it? No. Okay, thank you. And so this is one of my very first pictures when I was living in Middle East, shot in the desert. I wanted to show the female empowerment by materializing the strength of the wind. I came back to France 2 years after. And suddenly, it was obvious that I really wanted to settle as a professional photographer. But that as I didn't study photography, I needed to learn. I didn't have any technique. So I was learning by doing and making mistakes. At that time, I was living in a really, really small flat in Paris, and I had the chance to have a beautiful roof window, even if it was really tiny. This roof window helped me to learn to model the light and to understand light with natural light. And so I started to work with this light as a softbox. And I did this first series called Cocoon. It's based on experimentation with color skin tights, wool, and cotton. With this apparent fragility and filamentous aspect, those textures evoke to me the cocoon where all transformation can occur. So by a lack of technical knowledge, tools, and money, I learned to understand light with the natural light, and it became a signature in my light, because today most of my shots are done in daylight. When I felt like my portfolio was ready, I decided to show it to professionals, and I submitted my work to the Pictop Prize, which I won in 2010. Mostly with this series named Exodus, where the albino's characters go through a lunar landscape in an identity quest. This recognition helped me to have more self-confidence and a visibility to start to exhibit in galleries and to work with magazines, and then to get a representative. And 2 years after, I won another award called La Bourse du Talent with my Barba Papa series that you can see on the screen, for which I worked with Cotton Candy by using a childhood reference as Cotton Candy and choosing a young model of 9 years old who has a really strong adult look. I wanted to express the fragility of the transitional ages. This prize gave me the chance to exhibit to the French National Library in Paris. This exhibition made me step back and look at my work from a different angle. I understood that, above all, what thrilled me was to picture people's portrait and body, as if within the face and in the body language, I could find the essence of a person. My creative process often starts with a fascination for texture, most of the time an organic texture. Vegetal, frost, wool, cotton, wood, wax, skin hairs. When I'm attracted by a texture, I start to work with it physically, to play with it, and to divert it from this first use. I like to work with things that people look at in their daily life as something usual, and give it to see in a different way. As, for example, this series called Dandelion, where a weed becomes as precious as a jewel. For this series, I worked with a botanical artist named Duane Nanduk, and we worked with the wall dandelion, as you can see on the picture, and also just with the dandelion puff that has been placed on the face one by one. It was really meticulous work and long, as you can guess. This series has been exhibited in many different places, and recently we had the pleasure to be invited to by the French Embassy of China in the context of the Sino-French Month for Environment. And the exhibition went through 5 cities all over China, from Beijing to Changsha, Guangzhou, Shenzhen, and Dalian. That was a really great trip and experience. I would like to share with you this recent project I did for the permanent collection of the Perfume Museum that just opened in Paris. It's a collaboration with 2 choreographers named Axel Lagie and Julien Gaillac. This work shows multiple gestures related to the way we have been perfuming ourselves through countries and histories. For example, this photo is an illustration of a tradition in some African village. I quote Jean-Claude Elena, who is the perfumer of Hermès House. He wrote, "I remember having read that in Africa, the man who leaves his family passes his hand under the armpit of the other, who takes him to the exit of the village to keep the memory. The other one does the same to keep the track of the one who goes away." Another important part of my work is the way I choose models. Most of the people I picture are persons that I meet randomly in the street. I find interesting to picture people who doesn't have a professional relation with their image. It's most of the time because the human relation is more interesting, is deeper. In 2014, I did this series inspired by the performing art of the Bauhaus with this beautiful woman. We did 4 days of shootings, all in daylight. Although she really wanted to pose for the project, somehow to challenge herself, it was not easy for her, and she collapsed into tears a few times because of the relation with her body. I find beauty where I feel emotions and where I'm surprised. And this movement really moves me and surprised me a lot. In 2015, I created a new series named Praise of Detail, for which the choice of each model was the key of the project, as my thematic was to work on skin, hairiness, scarves, stretch marks, skin disease, color skin tones, and so on. All the things that physically sign the individuality of each one. I wanted to picture what does not belong to the beauty standard and magnify them, as for example, hairy legs. I really want to emphasize on this photo, this beautiful woman has a congenital disease. It was for her a really strong process to pose naked and show her back. Even on a beach, she's never just with a bikini. She told me that it helped her very much for self-acceptance and to give to herself a calm look without judgment. Talking about resilience, last year I had the chance to work with an art therapist in a clinic. The process was really meaningful for the patients, and I decided to pursue this path, helping people to heal a part of them with photography. So I'm now working on a project in Congo to help women who are victims of sexual violences. Although I'm really moved by the stillness of photography, I'm not too much attached to photography by itself. I see it as a tool to help me to capture the ephemeral settings I have in mind to make them last. What matters to me is the artistic direction of the image. I also work with video, and I'm developing art installation with my photographs. I like the fact that my creativity finds different ways to express itself. I also draw and practice spontaneous chanting and dancing. Creativity is an inner movement, and I need to go through my physicality in order to let creativity speak out loud. I believe that diversity is not dispersion, but enrichment. I love to cultivate a panel of art approaches that feed each other. Above all, I see it as a necessity to grow as a person. Thank you.
Excellent. Yeah, I guess you see what I meant. It's like a different idea and complexity and intelligence to beauty. So next up, here you go. Now this is it's going to be interesting. We had like a conversation before, and we were talking about like elephants and dancers and smoke and mirrors and feathers and like real big performance. No pressure on you. But I'd like to present Natasha Buslavsky and Boris Fabrikant from Tel Aviv. They have already been, or at least Natasha has been, part of the Edge Open presentation of Tel Avivian. But what they're presenting now is another project that I'm almost like grateful for, because I've spent a good amount of time recently, over the last couple of years, looking into food photography and like this whole kind of outburst of publications about food that are all extremely beautiful, and like for me, it came to the point where it started being boring, and it was just like too much craft and men with beards and stuff. And we were doing a book last year that is called
Divine Food.
Yeah, I always know the internal titles and can never remember what the books are actually called. I'm pretty useless as promotion. But the book was about Australian food from across the country, and actually also it was titled Israeli and Palestinian recipes to kind of promote the idea that maybe food is culture rich enough to help us come together and maybe start a conversation across our disbeliefs or different beliefs. And this book is one of those beautiful books, and I think it's right to do it that way, but you have a different approach to your food, your culture, and I very much like that. So please welcome Natasha and Boris.
Hi, thank you,
Sven. Hi, everybody. I'm Boris, and this is Natasha, and we are Sibaris Magazine from Tel Aviv. Actually, Sibaris Magazine is an art project that we started to talk about it about a year ago. When you ask people about Israeli food, actually, most of them would mention hummus and falafel as Israeli national food. Well, it's a little bit more complicated than that. In the 1980s, Israel suffered from a really deep economical crisis, which eventually made people go less to restaurants and go much more to street food stands. So this is a typical falafel place in Tel Aviv. So street food, actually, it's served in pita bread. It's very simple and healthy. It's from fresh vegetables, lemon juice, tahini, and falafel.
Today, Eyal Shani, a celebrity chef mostly known of his semi-erotic treatment of tomatoes, became the symbol of the new foodies movement in Israel. He is the founder of Chef of Miznon, which is a food stall elevating the most basic ingredients, serving cauliflower in a pita. I wanted to show you a video. It's a parody about Eyal Shani. No sound, but it's okay.
Yeah.
It's in Hebrew anyway, so. So you can see they really kind of laugh about his work.
Yeah.
So, basically, he was once mocked by the Israeli public, but he is now accepted to the mainstream and worldwide. Actually, Miznon is being opened some branches in Paris and Vienna, and soon to open in New York. So, Israeli restaurants are no longer viewed as merely falafel stands or hidden behind vague promises of Middle Eastern menus. Israeli dishes and Israeli chefs are taking central stage in the culinary discourse. So, we decided to dig in the subject.
So, for us, food is a central experience, of course. But it also unfolds stories about specific places and culture. We see food culture as a representative of social, cultural, and sometimes political state of people and social phenomena. For example, our first series that we photographed, the Israeli breakfast, which is a distinctive style of breakfast that originated on the Israeli collective farm called the kibbutz, which is a collective community in Israel that was traditionally based on agriculture. Now this breakfast is served in most hotels in Israel and in many restaurants. It actually has been called the Jewish state's contribution to world cuisine. It contains fresh vegetables, cooked eggs, and simple cheese. The Israeli field worker was feeding of modest and healthy breakfast to help him start the long day ahead working in the fields. This type of breakfast is now served in restaurants. There is one restaurant in Tel Aviv that is serving Israeli breakfast 24/7.
So Israeli food is a mixture of Eastern and Western influences. For example, shakshuka, which is an egg cooked in tomato and pepper sauce, a dish originated from the North African cuisine, was appropriated as a popular, authentic Israeli dish. This simple dish has transformed from grandma's kitchen to high-end restaurants. So you can find coffee stations in hotels, office buildings, and conferences. These stations were influenced by the kibbutz style of buffet serving. The buffet, as we see it, is a meeting point where Israelis like to load their plates with a huge variety of random snacks. In the end of the evening, you will find the station in a chaotic stage. So we took inspiration from this styling aesthetics and created the next series. So this is a black Turkish coffee with rogalach, which is a kind of a weird croissant. Burek or burekas on plastic bags.
Plates.
Tea with salty cookies, it's called abadi, with possible bananas.
So yeah, the next series that we photographed called the Romantic Mangal. Mangal in Hebrew, it's actually a barbecue, but it's a small barbecue. You can take it anywhere you go and start the fire. So we're especially interested in social ceremonies, which are concerned with food. Our Romantic Mangal series discusses the masculinity in the Israeli ceremonial gatherings. The men are usually taking care of the meat roasting, keeping the fire going. Once a year, on Independence Day, the parks and the coastline is filled with smoke screen and heavy smell of roasted meat. It is a tradition for families to go out to the parks and beaches and light up the barbecue, leaving behind huge piles of trash.
So the men are responsible for lighting up the mangal. This is the coal. They also get to enjoy the steaks because they leave it for last. After the shishliks and the kebabs and the everything, so they eat the steaks basically. And you can see some more photos from the series. It's a shishlik with a sunset and a trash can. Plastic bag and the sunset, very romantic. And so on. So for dessert, of course, watermelon.
And speaking of desserts, a special kind of dessert, the parve desserts. So in Judaism, parve is a dessert that it's not made not from milk and not from meat. In Judaism, the kashrut law forbids consuming mixtures of milk and meat. And actually, parve, the meaning of it is neutral. Also the taste, maybe. So in kosher restaurants, usually they serve the parve adaptation of popular desserts. For example, the malabi, which is originated from Turkey, actually, and made out of corn flour, cream or milk and rose water. And it's really tasty, but I can assume that if you will taste it, the parve version of it, you will never forget this day.
Yeah, so you would probably recognize this next dessert. It's the cream Bavaria. So it's originated in Germany, but it has a parve version, which is served in blue-collar restaurants. And it was very, very popular in the 80s. So it's interesting how this East and West is kind of mixed in the Israeli food culture, because it's the German cream Bavaria and the Eastern restaurants that serves couscous and so on. So the next work was a work we were commissioned to do by the food edition of Haaretz newspaper. It would be printed in 2 weeks, just in time for Passover. So it's a holiday, Passover, where the extended family from all over the world reunites in a large dinner. This is our interpretation of the Passover table, which is not here, but anyway. So we took gefilte fish cutlets, and we took them for a tour in Israel. Here they are suntanning on the beach, or floating on the Dead Sea. And of course, they went to the Kotel because it's the most sacred place for Judaism.
Oh, This is
the Passover table. By the way, the editor, she didn't return my emails. I sent it to her. They didn't call me back. I don't know. So
matzah, it's the substitute for bread in Passover. Actually, it's very hard, almost impossible to buy bread in Passover. But we were really fascinated of by the texture of the matzah. And another phenomenon that we observed that there is a lack.
Like nail polish.
Nail polish in the texture of matzah. So we decided to combine it like in modernist composition.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
We have... Thanks. We have a magazine in the Soda Books back there, so check it out.
Yeah.
We printed a limited edition of 250 copies, and it's all signed, numbered. Thank you.
Get one and leave one for me, please. I didn't manage to get one yet. Thank you very much. Right, and the last round would be with Bettina Flittner from Cologne. Yep, come up already. And I mean, as I said in the beginning, that there's something about the local, the detail, the showing the things as they are, or maybe differently enough so that you can realize the differences more. What I like a lot and what impresses me about your work is the fact that she goes out and asks the uncomfortable questions in the necessary places. So starting as a photographer or as a filmmaker first, right? And like a cutter and then going to film school, she has done a lot of what I would call like photo essays or author photography projects. And some of the questions that she asks remind me to a talk that I can strongly recommend. Moritz von Usler, German journalist at TEDx here in Munich, who talks about his, I think, 1,000 theses for like doing a good interview and asking like a politician the question, so, hey, what's up? Or whom are you in love with? You know, to break the ice a little bit. The questions you're asking are more severe, maybe. So asking the question, like, will we in Germany get the situation with the refugees handled to people on the street in Leipzig? Asking, are you a right-wing extremist? And what does it mean to you, to some youngsters in the like outskirt borough of Berlin, which is known to be a right-wing place? Or asking the simple question, what are you doing here, to men in brothels? So the rest, she's going to present herself. Please welcome
Bettina.
Thank you.
The problem I just have that I am hungry after this speech now. ja, ich freue mich sehr über die Einladung. Vielen Dank. Geht das Mikro? Hören Sie mich? Okay. Und ich möchte in den 10 Minuten, die mir gewährt worden sind, ein paar Schlaglichter auf meine Arbeit werfen. Ein paar Sätze zu mir. Ich bin nach, wie er schon sagte, nach einer Ausbildung als Filmregisseurin seit Anfang der 90er Jahre freie Fotografin. Und meine Arbeit hat eigentlich drei Hauptstränge. Das eine sind Porträts, das zweite sind Essays und das dritte Reportagen. Und die Porträts sind, da mache ich eigentlich überwiegend inszenierte Porträts und Porträtserien. Bei den Essays, das sind oft soziale und politische Themen, wie gerade schon angerissen, die auch oft mit Text arbeiten. Und die Reportagen, das mache ich für Magazine und NGOs und komme jetzt auch gerade von einer Reise aus Papua-Neuguinea zurück, von ein paar Tagen, wo ich eine Reportage über das eigentlich ziemlich ernste Thema Hexenverbrennung gemacht habe, die es da tatsächlich noch gibt. Ich veröffentliche, wie gesagt, in Zeitschriften, habe auch schon 10 Fotobände gemacht, habe einige Ausstellungen im öffentlichen Raum gemacht, davon zeige ich auch gleich noch ein Beispiel. Und eigentlich charakteristisch für meine Arbeit ist, dass sie oft Diskussionen auslösen und Debatten. Und davon zeige ich auch gleich drei Arbeiten, bei denen das so passiert ist. Also insgesamt zeige ich vier Arbeiten. Das erste ist die Serie Mein Herz, mein Feind, mein Denkmal. Das ist eine ganz frühe Arbeit von 1992, lange ist es her. Und das war die erste Arbeit, wo ich im öffentlichen Raum ausgestellt habe. Das zweite sind Beispiele aus der Serie Ich bin stolz, ein Rechter zu sein. Eben junge, sich als rechts bezeichnende Jugendliche in Berlin. Die dritte Serie sind eben die Porträtserie Freier, die ich 2013 dem Stern angeboten habe und der sie dann auch gebracht hat. Und das vierte ist eine Auftragsarbeit, die ich für 22 gemeinnützige Stiftungen gemacht habe. Die heißt das Prinzip Apfelbaum. So, bevor ich jetzt hier so viel rede, fange ich mal an. Das ist das erste. Das ist eben das erste Mal, dass ich im öffentlichen Raum ausgestellt habe, Mein Feind. Dazu habe ich Frauen auf der Straße angesprochen und sie gefragt, haben Sie einen Feind? Und wenn ja, was würden Sie mit ihm tun, wenn Sie es ohne Strafe tun könnten? Und diese Frauen habe ich dann in einen Raum gebeten, wo ich Spielzeugwaffen hingelegt habe und wo sie sich was aussuchen konnten. Die Bedingung war, sie mussten mir ihre Geschichte erzählen. Und das haben sie dann auch getan. Diese Arbeit hat damals sehr heftige Diskussionen hervorgerufen. Den Anfang hat eigentlich die Bild-Zeitung gemacht, die dann geschrieben hat, getitelt hat, Fratzen der Gewalt, Aufruf zum Hass. Und das ging dann irgendwie sehr weit. Ich wurde dann angezeigt wegen Volksverhetzung und Beleidigung und der Staatsanwalt hat ermittelt und dann kam aber das Kölner Kulturamt wurde dann angerufen, weil die bestimmen dann, was Kunst ist und die sind dann da über die Schildergasse gegangen in Köln und haben beschieden, es ist Kunst und es darf stehen bleiben. Also hatte ich nochmal Glück gehabt. Ich habe dann mit diesen Außeninstallationen noch ein bisschen weitergemacht, weil ich gedacht habe, wow, wenn man diese Diskussion anstoßen kann mit Fotografie und dann kann man eigentlich wirklich was bewirken und habe dann noch zwei andere Arbeiten gemacht. Das ist Mein Denkmal. Haben Sie ein Denkmal verdient und wenn ja, wofür? Und das ist Mein Herz. Haben Sie schon mal Ihr Herz verloren und wenn ja, wie ist die Sache weitergegangen? Das war eine Installation auf dem Berliner Lustgartenplatz. Jetzt kommt die nächste Arbeit. Ich bin stolz, ein Rechter zu sein. Da bin ich eigentlich auf die Straßen von Ost-Berlin gegangen und habe junge Menschen angesprochen, meistens waren es Jungs, die die Insignien der Rechten trugen, ob sie wirklich recht sind. Und wenn ja, was das überhaupt heißt, rechts zu sein. Diese Arbeit ist auch sehr stark diskutiert worden. Das ist eine Installation auf der Art Cologne. Die Kritik war, dass ich diesem Denken eine Plattform biete und dass ich irgendwo hätte schreiben müssen, dass ich nicht der Meinung dieser dargestellten Menschen bin. Aber das genau, das hat mich ja interessiert, eben solche Diskussionen anzustoßen. Die nächste Arbeit, Freier. Dafür bin ich 2013 gemacht. Dafür bin ich in ein Stuttgarter Bordell gegangen und habe mich dort an die Theke gestellt und die Männer, die dort waren, gefragt, warum sind sie hier? Das ist jetzt ein Foto aus dem Internet, weil in dem Raum durfte ich gar nicht fotografieren. Ich habe die Männer später in den Zimmern fotografiert, auf den Betten. Das hat natürlich ein bisschen gedauert, bis sich jemand hat fotografieren lassen, zumal ich immer gesagt habe, es ist für den Stern und sie kriegen auch keine Augenbinden. Es war nicht so ganz einfach und ich dachte erst, es klappt wirklich nicht, aber nach 4 Tagen hat sich der Erste fotografieren lassen und ich glaube, dass sie dann auch sehr ehrlich mir geantwortet haben. Ein bisschen schneller, weil ich gerade dieses furchtbare Schild noch 3 Minuten gesehen habe. Das ist ein Arbeitsfoto. Ich zeige Ihnen jetzt ganz am Schluss noch eine Arbeit, das war eine Auftragsarbeit für diese 22 der größten deutschen gemeinnützigen Stiftungen, also Ärzte ohne Grenzen, Greenpeace und so weiter. Die haben mich beauftragt, eine Arbeit zu machen, die 11 Menschen des öffentlichen Lebens porträtiert und die dafür werben, dass man sein Geld nicht seinen Kindern nur gibt, sondern teilweise auch eben an diese gemeinnützigen Stiftungen. Und das ist, das habe ich hier, das gehe ich mal ganz schnell durch. Da habe ich die Fotos gemacht. Günter Grass. Und ich habe das ist die Nobelpreisträgerin, die einzige deutsche Nobelpreisträgerin in Medizin, Christiane Nüßlein-Vollhardt. Ich habe eben die Fotos gemacht, ich habe die Interviews mit den Menschen geführt, also was soll von ihnen bleiben, wenn sie mal nicht mehr sind. Und das war nicht immer ganz einfach, weil die Leute ja teilweise schon sehr betagt waren, mit ihnen über den Tod zu reden. Und Reinhold Messner hat einen seiner berühmten Wutanfälle bekommen. Ich weiß nicht mehr warum. Ich habe angefangen zu lachen. Das ist ein Tipp, den ich geben kann. Wenn Reinhold Messner einen rausschmeißen will, fängt man einfach an zu lachen. Und dann ging es. Friede Springer steht hier im Wannsee. Da wusste ich auch nicht so genau, ob sie das machen würde. Und Wim Wenders im Planetarium von Berlin. Also daraus ist ein Buch geworden, ein Film und eine Ausstellung, die zurzeit seit mittlerweile 2 Jahren durch Deutschland tourt. So, vielen Dank für die Aufmerksamkeit.
Herzlichen Dank.